Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our current affairs. So today you have 8th of February 2021. All right, and we have the current affairs for your civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. So you might be aware that the few examinations like the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC, require you to answer few questions related to your current affairs. Okay, so you must read for that the day-to-day news from the national newspapers like the Hindu and Indian Express. Okay, so you can refer any of these newspaper. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. And here we are bringing also the daily current affairs classes, right, for your preparation. So you can also refer and subscribe our channel on the Future IAS for your preparation. All right, so here we are bringing you the day-to-day current affairs related classes. All right, so let's begin with the classes. Okay, so first is basically Startup India Seed Fund Scheme. Okay, so startups, you know, it's basically, you know, there are various, you know, push have been brought by the government of India for bringing up the startup ecosystem, right? Now the funding scheme have been launched, right? This funding scheme have been launched for the next 4 years. So this scheme is known as Startup India Seed Fund Scheme. Okay, this fund scheme basically would be used to seed the startups in India and ultimately to bring the startup ecosystem, ultimately, you know, to develop the startup ecosystem in our country, right? So the Startup India Seed Fund Scheme is approved by the Union Cabinet for the period of next 4 years. That is going to start from 2020, 21, 22. All right. So this Startup India Seed Fund Scheme that is called SISFS, which is going to be, you know, implemented from 1st of April 2021. It will be implemented to the next 4 years, which is going to be start from 1st of April 2021. Okay. As I told you that this scheme is basically all about the funding, or, you know, the seed fund which will be provided to the startups. Okay, so here the funding will be provided in the form of financial assistance, okay, to the startups. Okay, and it will also be helpful in terms of the prototype development, and also financial assistance will be provided to the product trials. Okay, it will be provided, you know, financial assistance to the market entry to the new, you know, startups, right? And it will also help in the commercialization of, you know, the startups and their products. Okay, so this is basically all about, you know, different objectives of this fund scheme, which will be mainly used as a funding mechanism to the startups. Okay, now 942 crore rupees have been provided as a seed fund for the startups under the scheme over the next 4 years. Okay, and that will be provided obviously to not all startups, but to the eligible startups. Okay, through eligible incubators across the India. So across India, the whoever the eligible startups will be eligible will be getting the funding or seed funding from the government. All right. And this scheme basically going to support around 3,600 startups. So definitely it will build the startup ecosystem in our country. Okay. It will help in achievement of certain targets which are made by the government of India. Okay. Next is Joshimath. Okay. So Joshimath is basically a city in in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. So why this Joshimath, or, you know, it is famous, or it is now in the news? It is because of the news, because of the breaking of the glaciers, right? So here the glacier, because it is located at around, you know, 6000 meters above. Okay, when it is located to that height of 6000 feet above, so if it's located to that height, you know, it is obviously the Uttarakhand where the glaciers are also there. So, you know, on the 7th of February, what happens is a glacier, which was there to that height, basically breaked off from the area, and which has led to, you know, causing of flash floods in the basically Dhauli Ganga River. Okay. And there nearby the Dhauli Ganga River, there is also Dhauli Ganga Dam, right, which is basically, you know, devastated because of that flash flood, which originated due to the glacier break. So all of a sudden, the glacier breaks down, okay, from their parent side, and then it basically came into the Dhauli Ganga River, basically, which led to, you know, the rising up of the water, and which devastated the dam further, and which basically endangered the safety and security of the people. Okay, so as I told you, that Joshimath is basically, you know, is a city where the municipal board is also located in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. The Joshimath is located around, you know, 6,150 feet, right? And it is also known as gateway to the several Himalayan mountain ranges expeditions. So it is also known for, you know, tourist purposes, right? Pilgrimage purposes, right? Also for other adventurous activities like trekkings. So trekking trails are there, like various expeditions also, you know, implemented over there to basically for the climbing purpose in the mountainous regions. Pilgrimage centers also located, for example, Badrinath. Okay. The Jyotimath basically is also known as a northern monastery. Okay. This monastery was one of the four cardinal institutions which was set up by Adi Shankara. Okay. And remaining three monasteries, which are at the Shingri, Puri, and the Dwarka, and this is basically the fourth one. So Jyotirmath basically is famous for the northern monastery, which is basically established by Adi Shankara, and it is located around 6,000 feet above the mean sea level. Okay, you can see here the flash floods, which is basically causing the devastation to the region. Okay, then Nai Roshni is basically a scheme. Okay. Which is implemented by the government of India, right, or by the Ministry of Minority Affairs, and it is implemented throughout the country. This Nai Roshni scheme is basically all about, you know, the bringing of leadership qualities or leadership development, especially in the women, or the woman belongs to the minority community. Okay, so Nai Roshni scheme is all about the leadership development in the minority women. Right, it is implemented by the Ministry of Minority Affairs across the India. Okay, ultimate, how would you bring the leadership quality or leadership development? Obviously, you have to empower the woman, which belongs to the minority community. So here it empower, you know, it try to empower and instill confidence among the women. Okay, how would you instill the confidence? How will you empower them? Obviously, you have to provide the knowledge, tools, and the techniques. By the help of the knowledge, tools, and the techniques, these women would be able to interact with the government systems, banks, and the institutions at all level, at the low level, local level, at the district level, at the state level, as well as at the center level. So ultimately, boosting or empowering and instilling the confidence among the women belongs to the minority community. Okay, and it basically includes the empowerment of trainee women. Okay, these trainee women will ultimately become independent. Okay, and they also become the confident members of the society. All right, and this scheme or Nai Roshni scheme basically provides the 6-day training program also. Okay, and it will be followed by, you know, a period for 1 year. Okay, the training basically covered different issues, which is basically most important for the woman empowerment. Right, like the leadership of the woman through the participation or in the decision making, right? So that, you know, their leadership ability also comes out if they included in the partnership decision making, right? So if they are involved in the decision making related to any sort of organization, obviously the leadership ability also will be brought in. Okay, then education program for the woman. Obviously, without education you cannot empower the woman, right? You cannot instill the confidence. You cannot make them independent. So educational program is most important for the women, right? Apart from that, health and the hygiene is more important for the women, for their, you know, better health. Then legal rights, which are provided to the woman, is also to be, you know, given to the woman. They should be aware about the legal rights. Then financial literacy. It is most important because the financial literacy rate in India is very, very low, especially among the women. So they should be provided all avenues of the financial literacy, right? They should be aware about, you know, their rights also. Regarding digital literacy, obviously the digital connectivity and digital empowerment of the woman is very important. So for that perspective, the digital literacy is also most important. Then their role in terms of the Swachh Bharat, okay? Then life skills and advocacy for the social and the behavioral changes is also being provided to the women so that they can become empowered, right? And they can become independent in the society. Okay. And this Nai Roshni scheme is basically implemented through NGO. Okay. These NGOs are basically empaneled, just like, you know, hospitals are empaneled under different programs. Like that, here to implement that scheme, right? NGOs have been empaneled by the government, right? And which is basically provided certain set of guidelines which are in the force throughout the country. Okay. Next is basically measures to population control. Okay, so now you know the India is going to become the largest or you know world largest populated country say in 2028, right? So which is basically surpassing the China also. Currently the China is the most populated you know country in the world, and the India is basically second largest you know the populated country. All right, and the government is trying to implement the National Family Planning Program. Okay, under this National Family Planning Program, okay, there will be some choices will be given, right, to the beneficiaries. So it will be provided certain, you know, the voluntary choices, the informed choices to the beneficiaries, okay, and through that will be provided through target-free approach, right? There will not be any target for that, so it will be target-free approach. It will be totally voluntary choices, informed choices, which will be provided, right, to the people. It will not be forced, you know, just like, you know, 1970s when Indira Gandhi was there, she did some, you know, forced sterilization process, nothing like that. It will be total voluntary, and in it, it will be informed choices will be provided, and there will not be any target for that, right? Ultimate objective is to check the population increase in our country, because the population is most important aspect, right? If the population is not controlled, obviously we will have a lot of problems in the future. Okay, for that, different schemes have been launched to check the population increase in our country. First is the National Population Policy. Okay, this National Population Policy have been formulated in the year of 2000, right? The ultimate long-term objective of the National Population Policy, right, is to achieve the population stabilization by 2045, right? So there, something peak like, you know, something like it should be there. So it should be stabilized by 2045. Okay, it should not increase further. It should be stabilized, and after that, it should decrease. So something like that, it has been made, you know, as an objective or long-term objective of population stabilization by 2045. Okay, then contraceptive choices, contraceptive, you know, to avoid, you know, the pregnancies and all sort of things. So here, the contraceptive baskets basically have been expanded, right, which includes the two new contraceptives. First of all, the injectable contraceptive, which is also known as Antara program, right? So these are, you know, injectable one. And the second is basically Centroman, which is basically Chaya. Right? The next is basically postpartum, you know, intrauterine contraceptive device, which is basically known as PPIUCD, right? Incentivized scheme. So under that, you know, post-delivery contraceptive device have been, you know, brought in, and that is basically based on certain incentives. Okay, then compensation scheme for the sterilization acceptors, right? Whoever been provided, right, some sort of a sterilization to control the population, that person will be provided a compensation for the loss of their wage, right, to the beneficiaries who basically undergoes the sterilization. And simultaneously, the service providers, say for example, you have, you know, the doctors, you know, nurses, all sort of a staff, supporting staff, which provide the service to the sterilization, right? They will also be provided certain, you know, incentives, right? So here the compensation will be provided both to the beneficiaries as well as to the service provider and the team which are conducting this sterilization process. All right. And then National Family Planning Indemnity Scheme, for example, during the sterilization process, let's say, you know, you might have heard about the news basically. Many a time what happens is the sterilization or the post-sterilization death occurs, or during sterilization death occurs, or some complications occur, or the sterilization completely failed, right? After port, you know, operated also. So in case of any sort of a loss in terms of death, complication, or the failure, right, certain compensation is to be provided to the beneficiary. So it is under, you know, National Family Planning Indemnity Scheme. Okay. Then Family Planning Logistics Management Information System, that is called FPLMIS, that is called Family Planning Logistic Management Information System. Okay, so here it is basically, you know, the logistics in terms of, you know, the commodities which is related to the family planning, right? So the those commodities, how you procure those commodities, how you basically forecast their need, how you distribute those commodities, right, at the all the labels, right? So here some sort of a logistic management information system have been brought in, which is basically a dedicated software, right, so that we can have the smooth functioning in terms of forecasting their need, in terms of their, you know, their procurement and distributions, in terms of, you know, in terms of basically the health related parameters. Then Mission Parivar Vikas, right, which is basically, you know, related to the increasing of the access of those contraceptives, right, as well as the family planning services, which will be provided especially to the high focus states where, total fertility rate, TFR, is very, very high, right? So if those states, right, which are known as the 7 high focus states where the TFR is very, very high, or TFR is more than 3 according to 2011 census, right? These states are basically Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, and the Assam, right? So these are the states where the TFR is more than 3. So for those states, right, certain, you know, incentives is provided, right, in terms of increasing the access to the contraceptives as well as to the family planning related services. Okay, then there is also a scheme that the contraceptives can be delivered to your home, right? So there is also the home delivery of the contraceptives by the ASAs. It will be delivered at your doorstep, right? And then you will have also the provision for the pregnancy testing kits, right? So where it will be provided by the ASHA. So drug kits of the ASHA for the use in the communities will be provided. Okay. The next is infrastructural projects in the West Bengal. Okay. Recently, you might have heard about the Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically inaugurated, right? Various, you know, the infrastructural projects. It is in the backdrop of the, you know, the legislative assembly elections is due in the West Bengal. Right. So, all sort of a political movement started in the West Bengal. So here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited Haldia in the West Bengal, and it basically dedicated the LPG import terminal to the nation, as well as the natural gas pipeline is also dedicated to the nation, which is 348 kilometers long, which is basically from Dhobi to Durgapur. It is also located in the West Bengal. Right. This natural gas pipeline comes under the Pradhan Mantri Urja Ganga project. So here the LPG import terminal as well as this natural gas pipeline have been, you know, dedicated to the nation by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi under Pradhan Mantri Urja Ganga project. All right. And the Pradhan Mantri also, you know, laid a foundation stone for the second catalytic, you know, ISO-DE vaccine unit, right, which will be, you know, useful for, you know, the reduction of the import of the lube based, you know, oils. So currently the India is basically dependent on the lube based oils. So this catalytic, you know, ISO-DE vaccine unit basically, you know, try to, you know, develop or try to manufacture such lube based oils in India itself, and that will be helpful India in terms of reduction of the import from the Western countries. All right, which will be a unit of Haldia refinery. Okay. And also the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also dedicated to the nation the 4-lane, the rail over bridge, ROB means the rail over bridge. Okay, so the 4-lane rail over bridge come flyover at the Rani Chak Haldia in National Highway 41. Okay, so he has laid a foundation stone to both of these for catalytic unit of the Haldia refinery, as well as the Narendra Modi also dedicated to the nation this 4-lane rail over bridge come over flyover at Rani Chowk in the Haldia on the National Highway 41. Okay, now these projects will also help Haldia to grow into the major hub of export import. Okay, so here because of this connectivity, because of this terminal of, you know, this natural gas terminal, as well as connectivity of this natural gas pipeline, as well as, you know, building up of this 4-lane rail over bridge come flyover, right, it will obviously, you know, makes Haldia, right, to grow as a major hub of export and import. This 350 kilometer long Dhobi to Durgapur pipeline will directly benefit not only to the West Bengal but also the districts of Bihar and the Jharkhand. So it will be beneficial not only to the West Bengal but also to the Jharkhand and the Bihar. Okay, and this catalytic, you know, devaxing unit obviously will be, you know, producing or the manufacturing the lube based oils, and that will help in the reduction of the dependence on the import related to such lube based oils in India. Okay, here you have the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who is basically, you know, making this, you know, catalytic ISO-DE vaccine unit under Haldia refinery. Okay, Next, the Central Research Institute, Kalahandi for the soybean. So here, the Union Minister for the Agriculture, right, informed the Rajya Sabha that the center is planning to set up a separate dedicated institute in the Kalahandi, right, for basically research in terms of soybean. So here, a Central Research Institute in the Kalahandi for the soybean will be set up, right, in the Kalahandi region, right? So here, the dedicated institute will be provided to the Odisha region, especially for the research and the development of soybean. Okay. Now, the Kalahandi district of the Odisha produces the soybean on the very limited scale, right? So now, to give the boost for the production and the productivity of the soybean in terms of, the particular, the climatic conditions, right? This research institute will provide further impetus for the production and the development, the research and development of soybean production in the Odisha region, right? ICR, Indian Council of Agriculture Research, which is basically premier, agriculture research institution at the national level, research institute on the soybean is basically already set up in 1987, which is basically known as ICR, Indian Institute of Soybean Research, which is basically currently located at Indore, Madhya Pradesh. Okay. Now, this institute, which is located at the Indore, basically conduct some of the research on the crops related to soybean. Okay. Now, the ICR also implementing All India Coordinated Research Project on the soybean since 1967. So this research product is all related to, the soybean production, productivity in terms of particular, the geological, particular climatological region, right? This, research project is basically implemented with the association with the state agricultural universities in the particular states, right? Ultimate aim is to, is to coordinate with the state agricultural universities to develop the location specific high yielding varieties of the soybean. Okay. Then also to develop some of the production technologies which are required to increase the soybean production and the productivity in our country. Okay. And this basically institute, which is basically also known as Indian Council of Agricultural Research, All India Coordinated, research project on soybean have one voluntary center, right, which is located at the regional research and the technology transfer station, which is basically located as Bhavani Patna Kalahandi under the Odisha University of Agricultural Technology, Bhubaneswar, right? So this regional research center basically located at the Odisha University of Agriculture and the Technology, Bhubaneswar. Okay, this station is undergoing the need based and location specific research on the soybean, right, especially for the hot and moist humid climate of the Odisha. This hot and moist humid climate basically located in the Kalahandi district, Bolangi district, and the Koraput districts of Odisha. Okay. Next is medicinal plants. The medicinal plants, all you people know about. The medicinal plant is all about, those plants which are helpful in terms of their medicinal use. Okay. So these medicinal plants, are very much important for your the medicinal purpose. So the Ministry of Ayush informed the Parliament about the medicinal plants. Okay, so the Ministry of Ayush is presently implementing following schemes regarding these medicinal plants. So first scheme is basically the National Ayush Mission, which is also known as NAM, right? So it is basically the centrally sponsored scheme implemented by the central government, the National Ayush Mission. So here, the medicinal plant component of National Ayush Mission is basically, supporting some of the cultivation of the medicinal plants in India. So it tried to incentivize the production, the cultivation of medicinal plants. So 140 such medicinal plants have been, cultivated in India. These are cultivated in some sort of a clusters or the zone within a selected districts of the states, right, where it can grow, right, and it will be implemented, and it is already implemented as a mission mode project in the selected districts. Okay, next is basically the central sector scheme on the conservation, development, and the sustainable management of medicinal plant. Again, it is implemented by the central government. It is a central sector scheme, right? The following activities have been supported under this scheme. So first of all, in situ conservation. In situ means wherever you have the medicinal plants, right? You will be, try to conserve them where they are located, right? So here, in situ conservation practices are already going on. Second is ex situ conservation, for example, right? For example, if there is a threat for any sort of medicinal plant in a particular region due to the anthropogenic factors or due to any other factors, right? So here the FC2 conservation, you know, practices have been going on also, where you will be providing some sort of, you know, the other environment where it can grow, it can flourish, okay, where you can grow them for the medicinal use. All right, then livelihood linkage with the joint forest management committees. So these management committees have been set up, okay, at the local level. Ultimate aim of the setting up of these joint forest management committees is basically to protect the forest areas with the help of local communities, because government has now, you know, basically, you know, understood that without, you know, incorporation of the local communities, you cannot protect the forest, right? So this joint forest management committees will be helpfully will be helping basically the livelihood related matters. So it, you know, livelihood linkages with those joint forest management committee also will be brought in, right? With the panchayats also, with the one panchayats, with the biodiversity management committees, with the self-help group, these all will benefit in terms of production of, in terms of conservation, in terms of development, in terms of sustainable use of medicinal plants. Okay, then IEC activities also will be provided in terms of training them, in terms of some sort of workshops, seminars, conferences. So such activities is also provided. Then research and the development, R&D activities is also provided. Then promotion, marketing, and the trade of medicinal plants produces also will be provided. So here, some sort of a promotion and marketing of the medicinal produce will also be helpful in terms of the development and the cultivation of medicinal plants in our country. Okay, next, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose residential schools and the hostels. So what happens is the central government or the Ministry of Education has decided to rename the residential schools and the hostels, okay? Especially those residential schools and the hostels which are funded under Samagra Shiksha of Ministry of Education, okay? So you have the Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan, okay? Under Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan, right? Residential schools and the hostels have been set up, okay? Now, the Ministry of Education has decided to rename those residential schools and the hostels, right? As Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose residential schools and the hostels. So they are trying to, or they are making, or they are renaming the residential schools and the hostels, all right, under the name of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose residential schools and the hostels, right? Now, why the Ministry of Education is doing this, right? According to Ministry of Education, this association of using the Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose name with the residential schools and the hostels would ultimately, you know, act as an inspiration, right? Not only to the children, but also to the teachers, to the staff, and to the administration, okay? Now, that inspiration will help in, right, to inculcate the highest standard of excellence, not only among the children, but also among the teachers, staffs, and administration at the school level, right? And definitely by associating the name of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, right, it will create the awareness, right? It will create the awareness, right, in terms of the facilities of these residential schools which are provided, right, under Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan, especially in the hostels also. And these are, you know, some of the residential hostels and the host and the, you know, schools have been located in some of the difficult areas, right, which inspire these schools to achieve high standards of quality education. Okay, these high standards of quality education will be helping, right, in terms of achievement of the literacy rate, especially to those, you know, backward areas. Okay, now the Ministry of Education under Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan provides also the financial assistance to the states, right, and the union territories for opening up of these residential schools and the hostels, for running up of these residential schools and the hostels, especially in the hilly terrain areas, in the small and the sparsely populated areas, for the children who are in the need of shelter and the care. So that means these schools and the residential schools and the hostels are generally set up in the hilly terrain, small and sparsely populated areas, for those children who are in the need of shelter and the care. That means their condition, their financial condition, their social condition is not good. Okay, so these residential facilities under Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan will be provided to the child labor which are rescued, right, to the migrants children, right, who belongs to the poor landless families, right, those children which are having without adult protection, right, as well as those children who are separated from their families, right, as well as some of the persons who are internally displaced. So you can see basically some like these facilities are provided to some of those, you know, children who are, you know, belongs to the migrant children, belongs to the child labor, belongs to, you know, without, you know, some sort of adult protection, separated from the families, right, which are in the need of such shelter and the care. Okay, now the preferences have been given to EBB. EBB ka matlab hota hai educationally backward block. Educationally backward block. Okay, so the preferences is generally given to the educational backward block, as well as LWE means the left wing extremism affected, you know, the districts, right, which are there in the Jharkhand and the Chhattisgarh substantially. Okay, then SFD means special focus districts. Okay, so here the important, the most important preference is given to the education backward block, to the left wing extremist, you know, affected states, to special focus districts, as well as 116 aspirational districts. Okay, so these are identified by the Niti Aayog. Special focus will be given to those, you know, to these districts. Now a total of 1063 residential facilities have been sanctioned to the states and the union territories. Among 1063 residential facilities, 383 basically are the residential schools, and 680 are the hostels, which are useful for the shelter and the care of those children. Okay, then Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, that is also known as FPMFBY. Okay, so ultimate aim of this Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana is to provide the crop insurance benefit. Okay, to provide maximum crop insurance benefit to the farmers, especially to the small and the marginal farmers. Okay, so under Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, a 16,000 crores rupees have been allocated for the financial year 2021-22 for the crop insurance benefit. Okay, now the budgetary increase this year is basically of around 305 crore rupees when you compare with 2020 and 21. So this year 305 crore additional benefit or additional budget have been sanctioned for this Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. Okay, this crop insurance schemes, you know, cover entire cropping cycle. It covers the entire cropping cycle from pre-sowing to the post-harvesting, right? That means once from the pre-sowing operations to the even harvesting and post-harvesting, right? For the any loss, it covers arising of, you know, preventing of sowing, right, because of natural factors, as well as the mid-season adversities if occurs, right, because of the weather condition, because of the climatic conditions, all are basically insured under this. Okay, this scheme was launched on 13 January 2016. Okay, so the 5 years completion already occurs, right, to this, you know, flagship crop insurance scheme, right? This scheme, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, is the globally largest crop insurance scheme. Okay, in terms of the farmers participation, so it is the largest crop insurance scheme. Okay, it is the third largest in terms of, you know, premium, right? And over 5.5 crore farmers applications are received on the year-on-year basis. Okay, and the Ministry of Agriculture and the Farmers Welfare basically implement this scheme. Okay, now in its revamping in 2020, this scheme have been made a voluntary to the farmers, right, after 2020. Now the farmers, out of total farmers who are enrolled under Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, out of 100% farmers, 84% farmers are basically small and the marginal farmers. For them, the financial assistance is provided, to especially to the most vulnerable farmers among them. Okay, so these are some of, the benefits under the Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. So 2% premium, for all kharif crops. Okay, 1.5% premium for all rabi crops, right? It is under one crop, one rate, basis. And 5% premium is provided to the annual commercial and the horticultural crops, right, for these. Okay, next is industrial parks. So here the Ministry of Commerce and the Industry, inform the Rajya Sabha about the industrial parks and the industries in our country. So industrial parks and the industries are basically, one of the cornerstone for the industrial development in our country. Okay, so the industrial park scheme was launched in 2002. Okay, and now, you know, according to Ministry of Commerce and the Industry, this industrial park scheme is basically applicable for any undertaking which develops and operates, right, any industrial parks, or which maintain and operates the industrial parks for, right, for the period, right, there is a period called, you know, from 1st April 1997 to 31st of March 2006. Okay, so any sort of a undertaking, right, which is basically running, operating, developing, maintains, and, you know, operates such industrial park between the 1st April 1997 and 31st March 2006, right, it will be notified by the Department of Promotion, Industries and Internal Trade on, you know, 2002, right? So this is basically for the industrial parks which are running in this period, right? And the data on the industrial parks have been established and the function in the different states, right? And you know, during last 3 years, it is not centrally maintained, but it is functional and established in the different states. And during last 3 years, the Department of Promotion and Industry and Internal Trade have accorded the final approval of setting up of one national investment and manufacturing zone, right, which will be set up, you know, under the name of Hyderabad Pharma City NIMZ in the Rangareddy district of Telangana. So, right, so in the last 3 years, right, the national investment and the manufacturing zone, right, will be set up or has been set up under the Hyderabad Pharma City, under the National Investment and Manufacturing Zone in the Rangareddy district of Telangana. Okay, now the different states, you know, undergoing the different, you know, the industrial parks and the industries, they are setting up of under the purview of concerned state government itself, right? And the central government basically provide the support to the states, right, through its schemes and the programs, right? And here, you know, to develop such parks, clusters and the industries in the particular region, right, once it is received, you know, from the center, from the state government, the central government provides the fund or financial assistance to the states in this regard. All right, so thank you very much for attending this class. We'll meet again tomorrow for your current affairs. Thank you.